Hi, I'm Terry Hobbs, and you're watching Bizarre Bazaar.
Welcome back to Bizarre Bazaar, and in this episode, we speak to Terry Hobbs. Terry featured in the hugely popular series of documentaries called Paradise Lost. If you've not seen these, I strongly recommend. It's essentially about the murder of three boys called Stevie Branch, Christopher Byers, and Michael Moore. Three teenage boys were later sentenced to death for their murders. Although the documentary says there was no real evidence to convict them. They were called Damien Eccles, Jason Baldwin, and Jesse Miss Kelly, known as the West Memphis Three. The documentary gained huge publicity, and famous celebrities backed the cause to get them released. Terry, however, is later portrayed in these documentaries as the actual person who murdered these kids.
Did you murder the little boys?
Well, I'd have to laugh at that and say there's something wrong with someone who would think that.
But it is something that he has always denied.
I was a step-parent back in 1993 when this happened. I was a good step-parent. And to watch it all go away on account of this, you lose your life to a degree.
He has never truly been looked at by police, I believe, because that in the eyes of the law, the teenage boys are considered guilty. I will remain non-judgmental throughout my interview with Terry. I want him to have a fair say, and it's up to you to make up your mind afterwards. We all know things in the media can be twisted, but if what the documentary says is true, then Terry is surely guilty. But if it's been twisted, then this is one of the most horrendous cases of slander that has ruined this man's life. One of the dads of the murdered little boys, Mark Byers, I think perfectly sums up how people were thinking during the making of this documentary. One minute it's all hate for the West Memphis Three.
Damien Eccles, Jason Baldwin, Jesse Miss Kelly Jr., I hope y'all all burn in hell and are tormented for eternity in a day. I couldn't ever put into words how much I hate you.
And the next is all aimed at Terry.
Once he hit one child, the other two probably froze like a deer in headlights. According to the medical reports, all three children, basically from blows to the head, would have died. And then possible secondary transfer, that's referring to his hair that was found in a ligature tied to one of the children. That's about all on the pro side you could find. Let's look at the guilty. Motive, means, and opportunity.
To be fair to Terry, no question was off limits, and he answered every single question. And I ask him some pretty heavy questions later on. I'll be very interested to know if this interview changes your mind on Terry or the West Memphis Three, so let me know in the comments. Before we start, if you want to write to inmates like I do, then use the service I use. It's called Jmail. It's fast and it's secure, and it means you don't have to use your home address. That's the main reason why I like it. I get physical letters sent to my home, but I don't give the inmates my address. I'll leave a link to their services in the description below. Just go check out the website. And if you want to help me out, please drop the video a like and subscribe if you're new. Hello, Terry. Thank you for talking to us today.
Well, thank you for having me on the Bizarre Bazaar.
Okay, I just want to say I've watched Paradise Lost, and like most people, I think that's where we get most of our information from, which is why I want to talk to you. And I want to start with, when you first found out the boys had died, how did that feel?
Well, at the time that it was happening, we had been up since May the 5th, you know, all searching, doing what parents do, searching all night long, and didn't even know what we were searching for. You know, we was just searching for our kids, you know, and the direction kept leading us towards this 3-acre plot of woods called Robin Hood Hills. And that's a piece of land right there close to the neighborhood where children, I guess, would go play. And, you know, we didn't know nothing about it, didn't know what it was called, you know, drive past it every day and pay no attention to it. So as we searched all night, You know, the police finally got involved with searches on May the 6th, around 8 o'clock in the morning. You know, we started seeing search equipment come out, and, you know, and the police. So, you know, I think it was in the early afternoon when they discovered them. So we got wind. We was at another part of town looking, and we got wind that they were looking or had found some boys. So we didn't know. So we headed over to where they were found. And when we get over there, there's vehicles and people up in there where in that direction. And we, I noticed a crime tape put up, you know, and that didn't settle good. But, you know, I went up to ask, you know, what's going on here. And I was told by Gary Gitchell, he was the inspector in charge of the case, that we found three boys and it looks like a homicide. And I stood there and looked at him, you know, probably in shock. And he says, it looks like they've been murdered. And, you know, I just sat down on the ground, just my stomach just fell plumb down, and I couldn't believe what he just told me. And I looked back. I sat there for a few minutes, and I get up, and I start back to where my wife was. And she just, her knees just give out, and she landed on the ground crying, yelling. You know, it was a shocking moment. You know, we didn't expect this. We didn't know what to expect, and we sure didn't expect that. That's what we found when we got to where we'd seen the crime scene tape.
I feel that the documentary gave us a good insight into this particular moment. At what point did the Paradise Lost crew turn up?
Well, Paradise Lost turned up in the first trial. Just before that, you know, they come weaseling their way in to want to make these documentaries. And, you know, I think us dads, there was three of us, and we all didn't want that, you know, because we didn't know what to expect from them either. And so they went behind us dads and got with the moms, and the moms signed the contracts, and they paid the mothers. So at the beginning, toward the first trial, is when they came about.
So you were all actually paid to be in the documentary?
Well, they, you know, give the money to the ladies, and, you know, and there wasn't no stopping them from doing whatever they wanted to do.
And just to set up the world a little bit more, when Damien, Jesse and Jason were arrested, the West Memphis Three, did people think that they'd got their people, that they were the right ones, or was there doubt behind the scenes?
Well, as far as the public and, you know, the families, you know, we were only being told by the police, you know, that we've made an arrest and we wanted everybody to show up, you know, their first preliminary hearing in court. So we did. And yeah, it was a rage. You know, people was mad that these boys had done this. People were somewhat satisfied that they, you know, they arrested the right ones. And, you know, so the journey begins. You know, it starts there.
Were you satisfied these were the culprits?
Well, I've always been satisfied as they were the right three, because that's all I've ever known. You know, and until, I've said this a million times, but until, you know, I see something else that leads me in another direction, that's all I know to believe.
So even though there was no DNA evidence linking them to the murders, and like it was being called a satanic crime at first, but that was proven to be false, like none of these kind of new revelations make you think any differently at all?
No, sir. People in this country, they can say and do anything they want, and they can make a circus out of a case, and that's all they've done to our case. Now, we on this side of it, we don't appreciate that. But you know what? You can't do nothing about it in this country. And there's some laws that need to be addressed. There's some things that need to change in America. because of stuff like this that is allowed. And no, we don't appreciate it. But like I said, you can't do nothing about it. They get out here and they slander everybody in the case, from the judge, the district attorneys, the prosecuting attorneys, the families. And there is not a thing that can be done about it in this country. And that's sad.
It is true that only the West Memphis Three look good in the documentary. I'll say that for sure.
They're not the angels that everybody thought they was. If people believe that, go back and have the people to listen to Jesse Miss Kelly's confessions. And he's had several, I understand that. But some of his confessions, he tells what happened to who, by who, and you will see that these boys was not the angels that they are made out to be today.
The most compelling evidence yet was introduced in open court. Miss Kelly's tape confession made to police.
I saw Damien hit this one boy real bad. And he started screwing him and stuff. Jason turned around and hit Steve Branch and started doing the same thing. Michael Moore took off running, so I chased him and grabbed him and held him till they got there, and then I left.
But it's said that the police coerced Miss Kelly to give these confessions. Is there no part of you that thinks that this happened, or do you believe everything that Miss Kelly said?
Well, I believe his confession. I think he thought he saw a way out of this, you know, and so he was going to come clean, or maybe he was the one of them that had somewhat of a conscience, you know, and couldn't live with it. So, you know, and he called himself going to try to make it right. And doing that, he implicated himself. And they already knew that, you know. But anyhow, he got himself, and he was just as involved when he chased down one of the little boys, brought him back, and stood there and watched them kill him.
How does it feel as a father when you're sat in court and you're listening to a tape of another person talking about murdering your son and other children?
Oh, it was. You know, sitting through the trials, we learned things that I never would have imagined. You know, these boys was out here bragging about it. You know, and I guess they thought, you know, they wasn't going to ever get caught up with. But in the trials, these kids in the town was on the witness stand, you know, talking about, hearing them brag about it. You know, sure, it takes a toll on you. You want to get up and slap them, you know, but you can't. But they can sure get out here and make a circus out of it today, and you can't do nothing about it.
How did you feel when they got released?
I was there when they got released, and I didn't appreciate it. I got my phone call like the rest of us parents got our phone call before the release, where the state was telling us they was going to release them. And sure, you know, he ended up in an argument, a shooting match with the police, or the state, not the police, but the state, the district attorney. And he just let us know, we are tired of this case. It's been 18, 19 years, whatever it was at the time, that they've drug us in and out of the courts on appeals, and we're just tired of it. You know, so we're going to make them plead guilty. We're going to give them the Alford plea. And we're going to release them, you know. And it's sure, that's, I know it's eight, I believe it was about 18 years, you know, when that happened, something like that. And I know that's a long time in prison, but look at what they've done. You know, they, one of them was on death row, one was life plus 40, and the other one was life, no parole. They didn't really, there's some sort of justice there, but not what they was, you know, given.
You said you were there when they got released at the court, and we do see this in West of Memphis. But at this point, you're heavily being portrayed as a suspect. I'm just wondering, like, how does that feel? It must be insane.
I tell you what, if all the documentary people pulled up in my driveway today, I would walk out there and slap them. You know, seriously, that's how I feel about it. I have done no wrong in this, and I have been threatened. I've been jerked off the streets by the police because of death threats. And I don't appreciate this kind of stuff, you know. I'm just out here trying to survive and live a life that's, you know, okay. And then you have to put up with this. I get the threats through the telephone. I get the hate mails. I get all kind of things that is senseless. You know, I haven't done a thing wrong to anybody.
And does this still continue today?
Oh, sure, yes, sir, it does.
And what did it feel like when Matt Byers is shouting outside the court, "There's the child killer, there's the child killer"?
Hey, there's the baby killer, talk to you. This free world, I can say what I want.
We were on the same side. And if in the documentaries, you know, they kind of attacked Mark Byers in the first trials, the first two trials. And he was their suspect. If you remember, he was the documentary's suspect. Okay, so things changed. The money started coming in to the people, to the families, the ones that would take it. And sides started changing. You know, so the more money you give people, the more you can get them to do and say whatever they want. Okay? And so I kind of believe that the more that they was given to my ex-wife, Pam, to Mark, well, the more they'd get out there and say things that they know is not right, but they're paying them to say it.
Is there any part of the story in Paradise Lost that we should know about that they didn't tell us?
Oh, there's all kinds of them. You know, a documentary is a biased film that someone makes, especially if their agenda is against what is being presented. Okay, so here we are in the middle of a triple homicide case. Here comes this documentary people who are subject to, let's change the tone of this. You know, let's say they're not guilty. And that's what these guys have done. You know, and they have spread the word, made their three or four documentaries. And actually, there's been a lot of documentaries made about it. But on the Paradise Lost documentaries, I think they made three. And they know what they're doing. They're good at it. You know, and that's what has caused the state to be picked on all these years. A lot of that is because of the documentaries and the system letting them do it.
How does it feel when you see your friend and main alibi, David Jacoby, and FBI profiler John Douglas talking about your potential guilt? And how does it feel when you're seeing your friend crying, talking about your potential guilt? Like, how does that make you feel?
So, I mean, what upsets me is I gotta stop it again. Here it goes. It just gets me that he didn't come back, you know? Look, why do you not come back to your friend's house to help you if you can't find your kid?
Yeah. Well, David Jacoby, he is a friend. He was a friend back then. I haven't talked to him in years, you know, especially since I've seen him on them Oxygen channels doing what he was doing, crying and all that. But again, you have to understand how John Douglas works. He's an ex-FBI profiler, okay? And his job in this was to go around and intimidate people. He tried it with me. I don't play intimidation. But David just couldn't overcome it, you know? And David bought into it when they pulled up on David in three blacked out SUVs, and he thought it was the FBI coming after him. You know, and it wasn't. It was just the intimidators showed up. And they did a number on David. And David knows the truth about, you know, for our mine and his whereabouts. And all we done was ride around and looking for us three little boys and just, you know, trying to bring them home. But David did. He did all that crying, and I seen all that, and I'm just thinking, really? But he was scared.
Is this why you're no longer friends with him?
Well, no. If I run upon him today, I would stop and talk to him. And I promise you, he would stop and talk to me. And he was a good guy. I've done a lot for David, you know. And in the during saying that, he was just a good friend. You know, he was a construction worker, steel worker, and a hardworking guy. Took care of his family, you know. But why? Oh, I guess the intimidation got to him, and, you know, he just couldn't handle it.
If you remember, how did they try and intimidate you?
The same method, you know. You know, my first encounter with John Douglas, why, I thought it was a nice one. He had his attorney friend with him, and I thought it was an okay meeting. And then, you know, between my first and second one, he goes out here and talks to everybody that he can or whoever he talks to. And I don't know, I don't keep up with it, but on my second encounter with Mr. Douglas, well, he is, you know, his tone has changed, his demeanor has changed, you know, and I could see that. I'm just thinking, you know, something has happened for this to happen, for him to start attacking me, you know. And I got up and walked off and left them, and they're standing behind me yelling at me to come back. I just wouldn't do it. I don't play stuff like that. And I can say this, too. He done it for the money.
Well, Kelly's court is back in session on the docket today. Meet Terry Hobbs. This man sued the Dixie Chicks for defamation. Why? Natalie Maines has been very vocal about this case, saying that new DNA testing would prove Hobbs was involved in his own stepson's death.
You'll raise your right hand. You swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God.
I do.
Okay, there's one more thing I want to cover on this. You sued Natalie Maine from the Dixie Chicks, and this put you in a position of being in court and being asked difficult questions. Is this something you regret?
No, I don't. I did sue the questions are just off-the-wall questions, like things I've never heard of, you know, but I had to sit there and answer them, and sure, it was degrading, and sure, it was aggravating, but you know what? At the end of the day, I told the truth about them, and I laid my hand on top of that stack of papers, and it was a stack, and I told that court reporter, I said, this whole stack here is nothing but a bunch of crap, and I stand by that today.
I understand. I just want to say as well, like, your family in the documentary, they defend you very strongly. It must have been absolutely horrendous for them.
They really done a number on my brother. They did. And it was so wrong. And my nephew, that was so wrong. And, you know, but still, people don't care what we say about it. They believe everything wrong. You know, just like it's the truth, you know, it's a bunch of crap.
When you say this, you're referring to Michael Hobbs Jr. when he told people about the family secret.
Yeah, we have family secrets. I'm going to say that. We have them. But it's nothing about hurting people. My family was in the restaurant business for years. We had 32 restaurants. Our family secrets are our mother's and dad's recipes, you know, and why they blew this up like they did about families, we don't have any, only our recipes, and we won't give them out.
So you're saying the Hobbs family secret is recipes and not you murdering three young boys?
Exactly. It's sad that people believe it, anything they hear. You know, and they take it for truth. I have got a lot of messages from people that tell me, I just watched a documentary, and they call me every name in the book. You know, and some of them, I explain it to them. These are documentaries. I call them docudramas because that's all they do. They're all about drama, you know. And some people have apologized, and some go on to believe the docudramas.
Okay, so where do you think they got these people from?
Like, they were friends with your nephew, supposedly, and they passed polygraph tests as well, saying that you killed the kids.
I'm not sure how they do all that, and I've heard the story, and, you know, there's nothing to it. But, you know, it doesn't matter what I say or what little Mike says. Little Mike come to me, and I ask him, my nephew, I said, did you do this? He said, no, Uncle Terry, I did not. But they put it out there like it's mean something, and it's just a bunch of made-up stuff.
Okay, the next question is probably going to be the hardest one I'm going to ask you. How did David Jacoby's hair end up on a tree stump at the crime scene? And how did one of your hairs end up in one of the ligatures on the young boy?
Well, you need to understand something. I'm not sure that that happened. Okay? I don't think this come from the police. This come from a defense that is out to hurt and do everybody wrong and to get what they want. Okay? And now I can say this. I'm not sure that that was. I said a while ago that that was David's hair out there on a stump. Because, and if it was, it doesn't mean nothing. And if it is, my hair in that ligature, and they haven't convinced me, and the police has never said nothing to me about that. But if it is, I don't care. It don't mean nothing. No, that was my stepson. He lived in my home for 6.5 years. And if it transferred any part, I would be upset if none of us parents had DNA on them kids. You know, they were our kids.
So are you saying that this is evidence collected by the West Memphis Free people and not the police?
No, the police has all the evidence, but people don't understand how defense teams work in this country. You know, they can target anybody they want. They can say anything about anybody. They got PR firms that they hire to, you know, to beat up somebody verbally, you know, and emotionally. And that's what they're doing. That's what they've been doing.
So you became the main suspect later in the case, and you were interrogated. How did this feel, and what happened?
Well, first of all, I had the statement from the police where they told everybody that Mr. Hobbs was not a suspect in 1993, and he's not one today. I've got that article, you know, and it come out of the newspaper. Okay, now first of all, I wasn't a suspect, ever. And second of all, I agreed to go talk to the police. They didn't call me in like I was in any kind of trouble. I agreed and said, if this will make things better, I will gladly come over and talk to you guys. But at the same time, in 1993, I talked to the police. You know, and they, you know, we agreed to do this, but I answered every question back in 1993 that was asked of me.
Okay, I appreciate that. What are your thoughts on the West Memphis Free themselves as people?
Well, if people have noticed, and I guess they don't really pay attention, all they have noticed is one guy out of the three says, I didn't do it. Now, I don't know if people noticed this, but here recently, Damien Echols has been saying, I want the ligatures tested. Have you noticed that? That is the only piece of evidence that he wants tested. Now, has people not figured that out? There's a reason why he wants only that one piece tested. He knows. Now, this is a bunch of us sitting around thinking about all this, you know. We're trying to figure out why just the one piece of evidence? Why not test it all? You know, I'm a parent, test it all. That's how I think. But no, Mr. Echols only wants one piece tested, and there's a reason for that. Okay? He did not touch them ligatures, would be my guess. Okay? And he knows that. So that's the only piece he wants tested. Now, at saying that, you have to notice that Mr. Jesse Miss Kelly said he left the crime scene early because he couldn't stomach it. Okay, so in from what we've seen on his confession, there was three people out there. If he left the crime scene early, and that leaves Jason Baldwin and Damien Echols. Damien Echols is saying test that one piece of evidence. He knows he didn't tie them knots. All right, so that's, to me, he's throwing Jason Baldwin under the bus because of that. Now, saying that, there was a necklace found after the trials had begun that belonged to Damien Echols, and it had our son's blood on it. Okay? They can't dispute that. That's in the evidence sealed up today.
Okay, that's something I've never heard of. And is there any chance you can tell us a little bit more about the necklace?
Well, we didn't know about it until the trials was going, but you know, the families were let know that we found a necklace by the state. The state let us know that we found a necklace in Damien Echols' trailer that he was living in, and it had Stevie's blood on it. Now, these are in the case files, if anybody wants to take the time to look. But now, this is in America. You can't, if you find something after a trial is going on, you can't introduce it as evidence because that sets the stage for a mistrial. So they couldn't use that, but they still have that. They couldn't use it in the trial. And no, your documentary people are not going to mention that because that's not their agenda.
Okay, thank you. Can you tell us a little bit about your book, please?
Yes, sir. Box Full of Nightmares. It's Terry Hobbs' personal memoirs on the West Memphis 3 murders. Okay, my cousin wrote this book, and it's just back, you know, years ago, 20, 25 years ago, I seen things happening, you know, that was wrong and right. I seen both sides of it. So I started documenting things and putting them in a box. And I filled up one box and I started working on box number two. And that is how the name came about, Box Full. And a lot of the things in there, you know, it turned into, you know, bad dreams, nightmares. And there's your title, Box Full of Nightmares. But I still have this stuff, you know, but that's how the book came about. And it's really, you know, it's really sad that I have to do this. You know, the story, I kind of felt like I was put in a position to do this. Because every time I would go to and talk to the media would edit everything I said and make me look like I was the bad guy. You know, and I got tired of that. So during my journaling, I addressed this. In the book, I addressed this. And they cannot edit the book. This is our work. And if you want to know some things about the case, you know, there's a few things in the book that people didn't know. And it's available on Amazon.
A link to that will be in the description as well. Okay, Terry, this is the last question from me. Did you kill the three boys that night?
No, sir, I did not. I'm not hurt by that question because I've answered that question a million times, but I tell the truth about that question. It'd be 29 years in May. Sometimes it gets you down if you let it, and I just try to look at the bright side. The good Lord knows, and one day he said everybody's going to stand in front of him and give an account. I hope I get to stand beside him with them three boys walk up in front of him. I want to hear this one.
Thank you very much for speaking to us, Terry. I appreciate it. Thank you. So that was my interview with Terry Hobbs. Do you still think he did it? Or are you seeing things slightly differently now? I look forward to reading all the comments. Until next time, stay sane.